I'm Patria Lanfranchi, co-owner and curator. Ride Studio Café is a friendly and welcoming and professional bike shop and coffee shop.
So from the roaster's perspective, if your coffee's changing every year, do you have to fine-tune your art every year?
Absolutely.
And is it better than to buy the third, fourth, fifth roast?
Often it is. Sometimes right from the start. But other times it takes a while to get exactly right. Right. There have been times where I've actually recalled coffee. Okay? Not very many. But I've literally written to every single mail order customer and such that we can find and said, forget it, we're sending you a new batch. Right? When it was really screwed up. It's worth it.
Did you do that because you didn't like the roast?
Yeah. Because the roast was just blown.
So you're talking about optimizing the flavor while you're developing the roast profile.
Yeah.
So I've noticed some roasters have stopped specifically roasting single origins for espresso.
Huh. Yeah.
And how do you factor in or balance optimizing the flavor you're looking for in the roast with the intended brewing method? Or does the coffee dictate the brewing method?
For espresso specifically, what we do is we divide it into two parts. If you're going to drink espresso, or maybe just one that's marked with a little bit of milk, right? But mainly espresso. That we still do single origin, single farm, to do that. But for milk drinks like cappuccino and latte, we do the one blend that we do, the only blend we have, Alchemy. Right, it's a darker roast. It's meant to stand up to the milk. That's the Alchemy. Now, if you like a darker espresso, that's good for that too. But that's its essence role is for the milk drinks. But we love doing the single origin coffees. Right, getting that right is the key thing because single origin can often be like hitting a lemon, just. Really bright, too bright, right? So it's a question of roasting it, softening the acidity. So let me say it another way. If you do if you take a regular roast that is great under drip, like the Kenyan you just had, you have to brew it very specially in an espresso machine not to have it scream at you, okay? You have to lengthen it. It's got to have more water, right? And softer. And this is an experiment that Sal has been conducting at our warehouse, right, is extending it. So instead of presenting you a 32 gram liquid cup, it'll be right to the top, 40 grams, 45 grams of coffee, stretched out. And then it won't have that shrill note, right? That's why we're taking these coffees and roasting them a different way. So we don't agree with a lot of these roasters now. We're saying we roast it one way, for espresso and for drip. Uh-uh. If you want a great drip, you've got to roast it for a drip. And if you want a great espresso, you have to roast it for an espresso. That's the way I see it, right? I think one of the more amazing ones I had recently is the Kanguno AB that we roast for espresso. At my cafe, and it was like going down like maple syrup. Just all the notes were there, and there wasn't a harsh note to it. Right. Very hard to achieve, I compare making espresso like landing a jet on a matchstick.
I feel that way sometimes.
Yes. Right.
Okay, next question.
If you started out with the same beans that Dunkin' Donuts uses, would your end product make a better cup of coffee?
If I started out with the same
beans that Dunkin' Donuts uses.
Beans? Oh, interesting. Yeah, well, that was interesting because back in around 1981 or so, I connected with the people roasting for Dunkin' Donuts. Dunkin' Donuts doesn't roast their own coffees. They find other roasters who have to match their quality criteria, right? And they're pretty strict about what they want. And so there was this this company in Boston. And for a time, in early 1980, because I'm learning as I go, right? So I'm stepping up. We were buying their Brazils, right? And roasting it our way, right? So, and then we graduated from that and we moved on. But they do, you know, yeah, I mean, but that's a different, I just remember we opened up two coffee connections in Newbury Street and we were really popular. I mean, these were huge success stories. Then we opened up on Boylston Street next to Dunkin' Donuts, right? And we just watched the crowds walk by. They never came in, right? I mean, that's the kind of loyalty. So Dunkin' was the beacon of light in the 1960s and 70s when coffee went into the trash bag in this country. And pretty much all coffee was dreadful. And they were the only ones who were actually having beans that were relatively fresh that they were grinding there and brewing there, right? And everybody else was selling infinitely worse coffee than that. They never lost that base. And for that, they have attained a kind of loyalty factor that is huge, absolutely huge, but deserved in a lot of respects. Dunkin' is their brew very mild, right? So that's like a 1.2% strength. Here, what are you doing here, Sal? You're doing 1.35?
Yeah.
1.35, much stronger. So right there, there's a big difference. The Dunkin' Donuts can vary more. It's the typical standard blend of Brazil, Central American, and then some other coffee. It can be Colombian or other. They're basically good commercial or just the beginning of specialty coffee kind of level, right? With no outstanding unique characteristics to it. But so, you know, if you were to taste it stronger, you would get a greater appreciation of what they're doing. It's that it is so weak that it really is hard to grasp. But I have to say, in 1975, it was Art Kramer, I think it was, who was on Channel 5, the guy who would make these comical talks about different things, and he did Portrait of a Coffee Connoisseur. And he took me to Dunkin' Donuts on Boylston Street. And so we're discussing things there. And then he asked me, well, what do you think of the Dunkin' Donuts? And I said, well, it's pretty good. You know, I don't want a lawsuit on my hands. And then he photographs me walking out of the place and without knowing that I'm being photographed, throwing the cup in the place.
So at various points in your talk tonight, you've stressed terroir. And other points, I guess, craftsmanship and sustainability. And I guess to follow in the gentleman's comment in the front about how growers and roasters deal with interannual variability, year-to-year changes, I'm wondering, I hope this isn't a trite question, but how does the sort of the coffee community receiving regarding projections of climate change?
Oh, yeah. Oh, boy. Big problem. Really scary stuff. Yeah. I think probably quite a few of you may have heard of rust or roya, as it's called in Spanish, hitting all of Central America. It started in Colombia, really, several years ago. Climate change has been a killer, absolute killer. Colombia, we saw, it's gotten better in the last 2 years. But before that, they would have rains when they weren't supposed to have rains, more in mass, if you will, heavier, much heavier downpours, longer duration, no sunlight at all. Coffee depends on some amount of sunlight. So you get maybe the heavy rain, but then the sunlight comes out and dries everything. When you get constant rain, so the same thing happened in Guatemala and elsewhere too. The dry season suddenly, like it was supposed to be starting to dry out in October, November, and then you get these hurricanes that suddenly came up the coast, and you had 12 days of solid rainfall with no sun at all. At a time when the beans were supposed to be coming closer to maturity, And this happened like 2 years in a row, this kind of like crazy weather. And then dry spells in the middle of the rainy season, back and forth. Things that weren't happening before. And so this fungus that has been in Central America for decades, since the early 20th century, suddenly goes from where it stayed at 3,000 feet, because there it's warmer, it's more humid, the fungus exists there, they can't eradicate it. But higher up, it was too cold, the climate wasn't right, it didn't go higher. Suddenly, it went up to over 6,000 feet everywhere. And so, and the sad, what made it worse was that, of course, it didn't hit all regions in Guatemala and other countries all at once. It would hit one area, but not the other. And almost every time, and this is so human nature, right? The farmer would say, well, I'm immune. Yeah, it hit that area, but we've never had it here. We're not going to have it. And then, bang. And it was like one pin after another falling. What was devastated was the organic coffee industry. Devastated. Because they only have preventative. And they had no idea what was coming. And so it just obliterated them. Obliterated them. Right? So right now, there's very little organic available, especially of any good quality. We found this a problem, too. I mean, 2 years ago, I wrote about how Guatemala was truly, out of all of Central America, it is the country that is the most complex, offering the most variation and nuances around. Because if you take a look at a topographical map, that's where all the mountains come together, right? And you have two mountain chains that are entirely different from each other. One volcanic on the coast with volcanoes right and left, and another one that has no volcanoes at all. It's older and that looks like somebody threw it up in the air and just let it fall again. I mean, it's just like this, you know, ocean in riot, okay, with waves going up and down like they're drunk. So two entirely different environments. In the more recent times, what we've seen is this wave go through region after region, and then 2 years of recuperation, where the coffees are not able to produce the nuances because they lack the leaves that give the energy to the fruit and the beans, because more fungicide has had to be used in order to fight this thing. It's been a real cost. It's been devastating. And it's estimated that up to 500,000 people were out of work because of this in Central America, right? So from large farmers to small. Right? So now several things are happening in regards to that. New hybrids, which scares us specialty people to death on the one hand. This is a rock and a hard place situation. The new varieties, these new hybrids, are necessary from the point of view of productivity and farmers surviving sustainably, but they're not producing the best quality because they have this robusta species in them that just does not produce the sweetness and the quality that the Arabica does. Will that change? We hope so. In Colombia, which has put the most money into looking for new hybrids, they're developing constant new strategies and new hybrids upon hybrid upon crosses, right? So they're in a multiple generations. And now, I don't mean to go into too much detail, but it's fascinating because they are now turning the game from checkers into chess. So instead of creating a single hybrid that now they plant everywhere, which after a number of years loses its protection, they are producing 12 and growing more strains of variations of this hybrid. So then they plant 12 plants in a grid so that no two similar plants are touching each other. So now if one plant gets diseased, the other ones around it don't. Right? And this is where we're going. This newer variety, we've been cupping it, may start to produce better qualities. But it's the same fear with wine, too, which attacked in the 19th century. There, the solution was a much better one. They could change the roots, but not the vine. Here, that's not the case. you really have to change the plant itself or find preventative ways to do it. And this is what's being searched for now. There's no clear-cut answer yet, right? We do see Colombia emerging out of it. I think Antigua's emerging out of it right now and doing better than it was. I'll know more next year when I go.
Hang on 1 second. We'll take your question after George talks about the Ethiopian Borboya.
Yeah, yeah. In floral, huh?
Does anyone not have it?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead and explain.
I'm happy with this roast. This is pretty much the pure Borboya. I think very light-bodied, tea-like notes running throughout, right? Sweet lemon, and very slight touch of ginger that comes through as well. Here, it's very mild, but it is somewhat present in there. I don't know if Sal or Jennifer want to add any more to it, but to me, those are always the notes I'm looking for in there. Anybody notice anything else on it? Ethiopian, this is from the area Irgashefe, which is my understanding it was first planted there in the 50s. This is not some ancient coffee going way back. And unlike other Ethiopian coffees, the ancient ones, the Harars and such, were in eastern Ethiopia, a very dry zone. These were washed, meaning that they were fermented, the water, you know, to get the fruit off, very fast removal. In eastern Ethiopia, very different than this, much fruitier, funky notes and stuff. The fruit is allowed to dry. It's a completely different process, but it dries on the seed and then you just hull it off. But a lot of fermentation notes, because the fruit gets hit by microorganisms and everything else, that enters into the bean while it's drying, so you get really funky notes, spoilage, everybody's got a different threshold for what one person stinks, another person is okay with it. And it's much like with wine, certain wines that way too. So in any case, with Irgashef, this starts in the 50s and becomes really noted for the unique flavor notes. This is your Ethiopian profile. If you get most wild coffees from Ethiopia that are washed, that's the flavor note. This flavor note may have been present in all the early coffees back in the 15th century when coffee really starts. And anybody who tells you that it was back in biblical times and so on is guessing. Okay? There is absolutely no literature that pinpoints coffee until the 1450 or beyond. Right? All the rest is pure conjecture. I'm sure it was done medically and stuff, and maybe that way, but as a social drinkable beverage, 1450 forward, that's it. It's a very modern beverage. But in any case, I'm not sure where I was with all this, but this coffee then is, yes, that's right. So this flavor note, when it goes, it starts getting grown in the Islamic areas of Harar, eastern Ethiopia, and Yemen, which is just across the Red Sea, very close by. In those mountains, these are extremely dry areas that require irrigation, very little water. So it's natural to have a natural process, meaning you dry the cherries because you ain't got the water to wash away all that fruit and everything else. You have to dry it. And so you get these funky notes. It's also a fact that the Saudis and the original Arabians drinking this special beverage were drinking an unbelievably light roast, way lighter than anything we're serving today. Okay, it was barely roasted at all, and it was more tea-like. So it was a very transparent beverage to which you added cardamom or other spices and stuff to make a completely different beverage that was much more like tea. And to add to that, I might tell you that it was the Chinese fleets that came around 1425, 1430, that circumnavigated the globe, not once, but several times. It were way ahead of the Europeans, right? And came to the Red Sea. and must have introduced Ethiopians and especially Yemenis to tea, the social beverage, caffeinated beverage tea. And when they leave, and they never come back after around 1430, there's a revolution in China, the fleets are destroyed, China will not set sail again for many hundreds of years, really, like they did. They disappear, the search is on for that social beverage. Coffee emerges in coffee houses 25 years later, right? So that's, to me, the real history of coffee is right there. So this, in the 50s and 60s, became a favorite component in espresso, right? So Ely always uses Ethiopian ergashef as a particular component in his espresso to add the floral notes that he wants in his coffee. And he is the guy, you know, it is Ely, unlike Lavazza, that uses pure Arabica and very high quality for a commercial company like that, right? Lavazza uses Robusta and Arabica combined, and you can taste it. If you've ever had a wet paper bag because of the rain or whatever, and that smell that that bag produces, that's Robusta, right? It will always have that note to it. So Ely gave a lecture here a number of years ago before he died, and said, and he was a chemist, that there is something in Ethiopian, and a particular molecule or whatever that is used in Chanel No. 5, and is also in Darjeeling tea. So for what it's worth.
So we're pretty much out of time. We have one more question, and then we'll wrap it up.
So how do you make your connections to the farmers? You mentioned auctions. I've seen the TV show Dangerous Grounds, where supposedly he goes straight to the farmer.
Right. That guy's on speed or something. Watch Dangerous Grounds for fun, but not for any truth at all. Okay? None. But in any case, it's very simple. Really, to my mind, with Cup of Excellence and this whole development of networks amongst farmers and so on, there has developed a network of exporters who are dedicated, who now see there's enough volume in specialty where they can make money actually selling those coffees. So when I go to Guatemala, I meet with at least three now exporters. There'll be a fourth this year. And I'll visit, spend time with each of them, and they will take me to new farms, right, that they've discovered and send me samples. So I go to there, I will meet the first guy, Jennifer and I will cup for 2 or 3 days, 60, 70 coffees a day, right, and pick out the best ones. So that's one way to find it, because they know what we're looking for, the kind of quality we're looking for, so we cup that way. So that's one. And then two is just being introduced to these different, having samples sent to you, when you're in Guatemala or shipped to us while we're here in the States. So we're constantly getting samples that way. And that network is growing continuously, right? So you've got importers that are searching on their end here that are very good, and European ones as well, who are doing more and more searching and pushing the envelope further. They can send me samples. Exporters can do it as well, who are more boutique size doing it. And then you get the winners of Cup of Excellence as well. So there's a Colombian coffee that Jennifer and I just cupped. It was the first prize winner for the Colombian Cup of Excellence. We bought a box, which means we bought approximately 70 pounds. And this was went on auction, so we paid $50, almost $50 a pound for that coffee, right? But it's only 70 pounds, and because I freeze the green coffee, a whole other topic, I can keep it all year round. And so we'll just announce it once a month, once every 2 months, that we have it, and those people who want to spend that kind of money, right, can buy it, and I don't have waste that way. It really, it's great. It, of course, it's not 10 times or 5 times better than another Colombian, a really great one. But neither is a $1,000 bottle Richebourg versus a really good Burgundy, right? It's not a matter of that. It's always a curve that starts to flatten more and more as you get to these heights. But you are paying, you are really giving incentive to farmers to really produce better. The point is never to be satisfied with where you are. It's always doing it the next step. And that's what these competitions are. So that's another way. So that was the original, to me, that was the search engine I wanted. And that has in turn spawned many other search engines, individuals who are searching, right? And as this knowledge becomes known and they see other farmers win it and so on, how to do that, the technology, the technique and so on is spread slowly to these farmers. So you have more and more chances of finding them. Yeah. Right, well, so I may, last thing is, so we may, you know, I will be connecting with our person in Colombia and saying, now I'll live with this coffee for a little bit, but I will be saying, I really want to connect with that farmer to try it again. La Esperanza, which we just got, and we're paying quite a bit for that, but nothing like that, right? We've been buying since 2007, and he won first prize in 2007 in Cup of Excellence. So that's one way to find him.
Thank you very, very much. That's all the time we have for this evening.
Great questions, by the way.
If you have
this
any
is really
other,
a great audience.
Any other questions, please email us. You all received an email when you RSVP. Just send questions to that address, and we will try to answer those on our blog. And we keep talking about coffee. Feel free to engage these guys in conversations about coffee. They love talking about coffee. And I think we speak for all of us when we really learned a lot this evening. And
before you go, okay, I just want to see who's favorites here. So, the Guatemalan. Okay. Right, okay. The Kenya. All right. And now the Ethiopian? Quite a mix. Yeah. Ethiopian is the one in these days. All right. It is really the most loved coffee right now. But I think these are ways of learning, right? And I've gone through that myself, right? And as the years go by, I think you will find that you'll want to check other things out. And you will find more and more to discover. So with that, thank you.
As a coffee tourist, yeah. What one city in the entire world?
Right now, San Francisco.
San Francisco.
Yeah. Followed by Portland.
Yep.
Not Maine, but Portland.
Yep.
Although Maine started to happen, too.
Yeah, it's getting there.
But Portland, Oregon is another world.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, the farmer wants to sell their second grade to the blenders, and their first grade with their name on onwards and upwards.
Yes, indeed.
Well, I'll see you there. Thank you very much.